About literature, we have already spoken. Literature is that part of the language which gives us entertainment. Now, one of the entertainment we have seen, that is audio visual entertainment drama. We have seen it and we have heard it, we enjoyed it. Now, another part of entertainment we are going to have here, that is story, short story. Short story has its own important place in the literature of every language. Whatever the language may be, we are having about 26 languages, that is what we have recognized. But unrecognized, many more are there, many dialects are there. But in every dialect, in every recognized language, non-recognized language, everywhere, there are stories told, retold, heard, read, written. Right? So, for example, I can tell you Kasi Majli Kadalu, we are having in Telugu. And Arabian Nights, in English we are having. Sindbad the Sailor, that also we are reading very interestingly. Gulliver and his travels, we read them also. Right? If we go on telling these things, we may compile many words of this height, maybe more. But a compilation of one book, I can tell you, Paravastu Chinnaya Suri garu rachinatuvanti Neeti Kadalu, Neeti Chandrika, aa kadalu, Panchatantramu antam manam. Aa Panchatantramu dantlonu, only animals he has taken. With the animals, he had taught many management tricks over there. Right? And all these stories, they are both for entertainment and to learn something out of it. Whatever the story may be, it doesn't go without a moral and it doesn't go without teaching anything to you. So, why I'm telling much about the story is we are going to read a story here that is adapted from our Hindu stories only and it has been translated into English because many of them have been translated. Short stories, if you want to know the writers, the very funny writers, there are many. In Telugu also they are, and in Hindi, Prem Chand. And he had written about 250 stories in Telugu, in Hindi. Very funny stories. And he just filtered the society, and he put all the characters of the society there, and he made mockery of it. Everybody, he did not leave. Even a Brahmin, he did not leave. A police inspector, he did not leave. Likewise, Prem Chand, he is a, people say he is a novelist, but I say he is a storyteller, a very beautiful storyteller he is. And now, Rabindranath Tagore, there are many, and the foremost and many people knowing the story is Kabuliwala. Likewise, so we come across many stories, and here we are having one story. Let me read it for you, because it is only entertaining. Read, understand, and entertain yourself. I am reading. Margaret Sheikh has chosen a very well-known Indian folk tale for retelling in English. Now, Margaret Sheikh, he has retold many of Indian stories in English. Children and adults alike are fond of folk tales. Folk tales, if it is a tale, if it is a story, children are attracted towards the grandparents mainly because of the stories. Because they tell stories, Rama, Krishna stories and all these things. And they are attracted. Once upon a time, there was a king. He had 7 children. This is a long told story. Mother to child, child to mother. Again, 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 it is told. But till today, we are hearing it. Right? That is how it has been told. Children and adults alike are fond of folk tales, which are often amusing and sometimes instructive. Story is that. It should be amusing, as I said, entertaining, and also instructive. Instructive means it should give a moral. Do like this only. Don't do like this. That is instructive. Didacting also we call it. It was dark. Thick black clouds covered the evening sky. The thunder roared and the strong wind shook the branches and leaves of the trees in the forest. Pit, pit, pit-pat, pit-pat, drops of rain fell. Then The lightning flashed and split the black sky with its blinding light. Soon it was raining heavily. An old tiger ran through the rain looking for shelter. He was wet and cold, and his cave was far away. While hurrying to his shelter, he saw an old hut. With a sigh of relief, the tiger crawled under the thatched roof and lay down by the door. Except for the sound of the rain, all was quiet. Before he could nod off, however, he heard something heavy being dragged inside the hut. This was followed by the voice of a woman. "Oh, how terrible this leak is," she complained. "How terrible! I would rather meet a tiger in the forest than have this leak in my house." "A leak?" the tiger thought. "What is a leak?" "It must be very dangerous and strong, or the woman would not be more frightened of the leak than of me. I am not rightly called the king of the forest. Aren't they all afraid of me? I wonder what a leak looks like." Soon after, the tired tiger fell asleep. He was suddenly awakened by an angry voice shouting in his ear. He felt heavy blows fall upon his head and shoulders. "You horrible beast," a voice screamed angrily. "How dare you run away? How dare you make me walk about in the middle of the night trying to find you? Be careful. One of these days I'll kill you. Now go home." The old tiger shivered. This must be the leak. Who has come out of the hut? I would better do as he says, or he will kill me. So the tiger allowed himself to be bound around the neck with a thick rope. The mysterious creature then climbed onto the tiger's back and pulled at the rope. "Come on. Head for home," shouted the voice. The tiger felt a sharp kick in his side. The tiger was terrified and he ran through the dark forest. The creature pulled hard on the rope to tell him which way to go. At the same time, it scolded, cursed, and kicked the poor tiger. Soon, they stopped in front of a small hut on the edge of the thick forest. The creature climbed down from the tiger's back and bound him with an iron chain to the nearby tree. Then he went inside the hut. The tiger could not free himself from the chain, so he had to spend a miserable night under the tree. Who was this creature who was able to capture such a large and dangerous tiger? Let's find out. On the afternoon of that day, a potter had arrived home after a hard day's work. He was tired and thirsty. He had asked his wife for some palm wine. The more he drank, the better he felt. When he had drunk all the wine, he no longer felt tired. When the storm began, the potter suddenly remembered that he had left his donkey tied under a tree. He rushed out of his hut to take the animal into the stable. You can imagine his anger when he discovered that the donkey was not there anymore. The only thing left was its chain. "My stupid donkey must have run off into the forest," he grumbled. "When I catch him, I will give him a good beating." The potter walked through the West Forest. When it became dark, he often stumbled over roots and fallen branches. With each step, the potter felt angrier and angrier with his donkey. When I catch him, I will tie him up under the tree all night, he muttered to himself. Hours later, the potter reached the old woman's hut. There he saw an animal sleeping in front of the door. There he is, he shouted. There he is, the stupid animal. The drunken potter did not notice the difference between the donkey and a tiger. He kicked the beasts, he kicked and bet the sleeping tiger. He then jumped onto the frightened animal's back, rode it home, and then tied it up with the iron chains. Next morning, the villagers who passed the potter's house looked in amazement at the tiger tied to the tree. Soon the news spread throughout the village that the potter had caught a tiger and tied it to a tree in his yard. All the villagers praised his courage. They also thanked him because the tiger had eaten many of their goats and buffaloes. They had tried to catch him for many years but had failed. Of course, the potter said that he had done nothing of the sort. He said that he had only brought his donkey home. He did not understand how a donkey could change into a tiger. When he saw the tiger, he fainted. Nobody, however, believed the potter's story. The villagers even praised him for being modest. Soon the potter became famous. Everybody who met him called him the brave potter. The simple potter himself never understood why. A few years later, war broke out between the potter's country and a much stronger neighbor. The king immediately gathered a large army, but he realized that it was not strong enough to save his country from defeat. He needed a hero to lead his army. Where could he find such a brave man? The king hurriedly called his ministers together and asked their advice. One of the ministers remembered the story of the brave potter. Your Majesty, the minister said, I know someone who can lead our army. The king immediately sent a messenger to the potter's house. When the potter realized that he had been made general of the army, he became frightened. The king had ordered him to go to the palace the next day. How could he, a poor ignorant potter, become the general of the army? He had never carried a sword, nor he had ever ridden a horse. Oh, I shall die because of that stupid donkey, groaned the potter to his wife. He has only brought us trouble. The next day, he went with his wife to the capital. The king was pleased to see him and ordered the potter to lead the army into the battle the next day. The enemy were not far from the gates of the city. A splendid house had been prepared for the potter and his wife. The horse which would carry him into the battle was ready in the stable. That night, the potter could not sleep. He was nervous and worried because he did not know how to ride a horse. If I fall off, everybody will laugh at me, he thought. I will get up very early tomorrow and practice riding the horse. At dawn, the potter woke up his wife and they went to the stable. They saw the beautiful black horse ready for its new master. "Oh, how tall he is," sighed the potter. "I shall never be able to climb onto this horse back." "Put this bench beside him," said his wife, "and see it as a step." Even with the help of the bench, the potter had much difficulty climbing onto the horse's back. When he was finally seated, he found that the saddle was very slippery. "Please tie my feet to the stirrup, dear wife," said the potter. "Otherwise, I shall certainly fall off." His wife found some rope and bound her husband's feet tightly to the stirrup. She then passed the rope underneath the horses and tied the two stirrups together. She also passed a length of rope around the potter's waist and tied him to the saddle. "Now, please tie my hands to his neck," said the potter. Meanwhile, the big black horse was impatiently pawing his hooves on the ground. When the potter's wife, tried to pass another rope around its neck, the horse suddenly jumped free. It galloped out of the stable with the potter hanging like a sack of rice on his back. Only the ropes kept him from crashing to the ground. The potter held tightly to the horse's neck and prayed to all the gods to save his life. After galloping through the quiet streets, the horse crashed through the city gates and raced across the open fields. It leapt over fences and streams and began to head for the enemy's camp. When the potter realized where they were going, he tried harder than ever to stop the horse. He pulled wildly on the reins, but it was no use. The horse galloped on. When they passed a young tree, the potter grabbed a branch, but the horse did not stop. Instead, the tree was pulled off the ground. A sentry from the enemy camp saw the potter galloping towards the camp with a tree in one hand and his reins in the other. "That must be the general who captured a tiger with his bare hands," he thought. "Now he has uprooted a tree with only one hand. He is not an ordinary man, he is a giant. Run, run, save yourselves. The famous tiger general is coming at the head of a large army to attack us. He has the strength of a giant. He has uprooted a tree with one hand." The frightened soldiers fled. The king was left by himself in the tent. Hurriedly, he wrote a letter begging a peace and apologizing for attacking the country. He left this letter in the tent. Then he jumped on his horse and followed his soldiers. When the potter's black horse reached the deserted camp, it stopped. With shaking hands, the potter untied his feet and fell to the ground. When he looked around, he was surprised to find the camp empty. He looked in the king's tent and found the letter. The puzzled potter walked back to the city with the letter in his pocket. He went to his wife and gave her the letter. "Dear wife," he said, "never in my life will I ride a horse again. Please take this letter to our king and tell him that the enemy has run away. I am going to bed. his wife ran towards the palace with the letter. When the king read the letter, he was full of surprise and praise for his new general. He asked the potter's wife where her husband was. "My husband is tired, Your Majesty. The servants have put him into bed," answered the wife respectfully. "Let him rest today. Tell him to come tomorrow to receive his reward," said the king. Next morning, the potter went to the king's palace. He left the black horse in the stable and walked to the palace with his wife. The streets were filled with the cheering crowds. They had all heard about his brave action. "Look how humble he is," they said to each other. "Any other man would ride to the palace on a horse, but he is walking like an ordinary man. He is truly a humble and brave man." The king rewarded the potter so well that he did not need to work again. The country was peaceful for the rest of his life, and the potter never rode a horse again. So you must have enjoyed the story when I was reading it, right? Now, let us go through the story, what it is and what entertainment it has given to us, and what is the moral it has given to us, what is the lesson we are learning through this story. It is a very simple story about a potter. Potter means one who makes the pots. One who makes the pots, right? A question for you. Why these pots are made round shaped alone? Did you get my question? Once again. Why the pots are made in round shape alone? Why not in a square type, just like our tins? Why can't they be done in any other shape than your round shape? The answer is the wheel, potter's wheel, goes round and round and round. And the potter can put his hands to shape that earth into round one only, not into square type, right? So potter is also skillful, right? And potter is also intelligent. When summer comes, you must have come across many pots over there with taps, without taps, and all these things, because we have to put the water there in that one, and it cools. The pot cools the water, right? Who made it? No mechanical engineer over there. Yeah, only a simple potter takes some kind of mud. What kind of mud? What type of mud? Only he knows. We do not know. He brings it. And what treatment he does to the earth, he only does know it. We do not know. And he makes many shapes. Even the smallest one in which we put this Diwali lamps, the very smallest one, how round shaped it is and how shallow it is to contain the oil, and how small even our hands, fingers may not hold it, but he makes it in such a precise manner. And so I call him very intelligent, very engineering man he is, right? Now we are going to learn about a potter, right? Potters means, you see, their job is only with the mud. So whatever you call with the mud, they are very quick in answering, are very intelligent with that, maybe brave with that. But other than that, they are coward. They are not brave enough. Modest, we can say. They are very, what we call as a very mild people, the potters. Now we have the hero here, a very mild potter. And a potter, you know, he has to work day and night. In the afternoon, he had to make the pots, and he had to burn them to the requirement, and he had to take them on the back of its donkey to the market and sell them and come back home. Only when he has a good market, he'll be having good money. If he doesn't have good market, he will not be having money, right? That way, the potter was very busy the day long. And when he had come home, he had a little amount of palm palm wine he has. That is Sarai Kallu. The palm wine, he takes it. Why? He got tired and he wanted relaxation. And so he took it. And after one drink, he felt relaxed. After one more drink, he felt further relaxed. Now, he was in a very relaxing mood and tiresomeness has gone from him and he is very ease. He was at home. And the evening grew. And when the evening grew, it started raining. When it started raining, it was just raining and from very slow motion to heavy. Heavily it started raining. There was lightning also, as if both the clouds were splitted and there was a line of light. That way it was lightning. It is dark, lightning and raining. Now you can understand how frightful the nature has grown. The nature was that. And before when the rain started, the generous porter, he wanted to make his donkey comfortable. And he wanted to bring the donkey into its stable. For his horror, he could not find the donkey where he tied earlier. The chain was left over there, the donkey was not there. Now, this is the situation with the porter. There was a tiger in the jungle, in the woods. And the tiger, because it was hunting and because it was old enough even, it was going, walking in search of its food and walked away from its den. Then it grew darker, it grew evening, darker and cloudy and raining and lightning. Right? That means in the same situation, one porter and here tiger. How these two met together, that is the story here. And it brought about a complete change in porter's life. Right? Now the tiger, it was weary. The day long it was going, walking away from the den. Now it wanted to return back to the den. It was leaping, it was running, it was walking. But because it is raining, it could not see. It was dark, it could not see. And it wanted a shelter somewhere. It wanted to hide itself. When it was walking so, it by chance, it comes across a hut. Hut, you know, mud walls and thatched roof. Thatched means with that paddy. Grass will be there, that is called thatch, it will be covered. Or else with the palmia leaves, it will be covered, that is called thatch. And that is a hut. And the hut will be having these palmia leaves so low, means if at all you have to enter, you have to creep through it. That is called hut. When it has seen the hut, and it felt relieved, and it crawled under it, and it slept over there. Once again, when it has come across this hut, it has seen the hut and it crawled under the roof and took shelter there. This is the situation of the tiger. It was about to close its eyes and go into a sweet slumber. But something made it startled. What is that? From inside the hut, it heard a noise as if something is being drawn, dragged. What is that sound? It doesn't know, but it is a heavy sound. Then it followed by a grumbling voice of a woman, the occupant of the hut. What is that one? It was scolding the leak. Leak, you know. Leak means a gap in between the ceiling. And leak means from the gap there should be water inside or the sun rays inside. That is called leaking. Right? How dangerous it is? If it is rainy season, is it not? We have to keep something under. Right? This the old man grumbled upon. What is it done? I feel it better to face a tiger than face a leak. The tiger was hearing this from the veranda. What? The woman feels better to face me than that leak. Oh, the leak must be some ferocious animal, right? More ferocious than what I am. The tiger thought, I am the king of the jungle, people say. No, I am not the king. Why? The complete day I was working, I was searching for food, and I could not go back to my den. And here the woman is not frightened of me. She chooses better to meet me than that leak. Must be this leak is something which is dangerous. Anyway, why I should think about, let me go and sleep. That way it was about to sleep. And his weary eyes got shut and went into sleep. Then let us talk about this our potter again. The potter, as he did not find his donkey at the tree where he supposed he had tied it, he, in the rain itself, he started searching for the donkey. One thing, poor donkey, it is raining heavily. It may lose its way or its complete existence. So he was walking into the jungle in search of the donkey. And while he was going so, it was heavily raining, first thing. Second, there were many branches broken due to the wind and fallen down. He was stumbling over these tree branches and big boulders which were there. And there were many thorns also. He was stepping on them. Then the anger, it is growing by inches and inches within himself. First of all, the foolish donkey went into jungle. Second, it went into the jungle though it is raining. Second, third again, and he was to go during that miserable night into the jungle in search of this donkey. So these three things made him angry to angrier to angriest. And not only that, the path is not a smooth path. It was filled with branches, stones, and thorns. And so his anger was increasing as he was stepping forward and forward and forward. Very beautiful here in the story it was told, how the anger was increasing, how he was walking. Then walking, at a long walking, he reached to the hut where this tiger was sleeping. Right? 1 + 1 = 2. Then this fellow had seen the tiger taking rest under the roof of the low hut. Only the legs were visible, and he thought it to be his donkey. Immediately rushed to the animal, and he brought some rope. No, he put it around the neck. He tied it and he sat on its back and started scolding. You foolish brute, right? You brutish animal, what are you thinking? You want to escape from me? Go away from the house? Did you see the thing? That way he started grumbling on it and started kicking on its back as if he is riding the donkey. Having these two getting the kicks, having these two ears, the words, and the neck is tied, and somebody very heavy sitting on its back. Never a tiger felt this kind of misery. That is sorrow, right? And so it started running. All along this man was scolding. All along it was running. But the tiger was made to run towards the potter's hut because he was holding the rope. And whenever he was pulling it very hard, it has to turn to that side. That way, directed by the potter on the back, it has reached the potter's hut. Lastly, the potter climbed down the tiger and tied the tiger with the chains to the tree and put some more scolding without seeing the animal which he has ridden, he entered into the hut and slept. Very soon, it was dark and the day broke. The people started going by his hut. For their horror, they had seen the tiger over there, tied to the tree with the chains in front of the potter's house. And they again put one and one together, they made it two. What is that one? Our potter is very brave. Went into the jungle yesterday night, caught hold of the tiger, which was making mischief to us. That is, the villagers were also somewhat troubled by the tiger. Here one goat, there one buffalo, here some chicken, there some calf. It was killing and eating away. By this, they were relieved. And so they went on telling everybody, whomever they come across, that our potter is a very brave fellow. He caught hold of the tiger, which was making nuisance to us. That way, this news spread all over. That is the first part of the story. And here you see how chance has come to the potter. Was he brave? He was not brave. What was he supposed to catch? His own donkey, foolish one. What did he catch? A tiger he caught. What was the tiger thinking all along? The tiger was thinking that the ferocious animal which that woman referred in the hut, Leek, must be there on its back. You see, everything, whenever there is a chance, everything will be falling into your lap. You have to understand, it is my chance. I will have to make use of this. Everything is a chance. If you are winning, it is a chance. If you are getting 10 out of 10, it is a chance. If you are losing it, it is also a chance. If you are getting 9 out of 10, it is also a chance. It is a chance. Luck. People call it as a luck, but I call it as a chance. It is a chance only. Right? Then here the story does not end. Though the potter caught hold of the tiger, he tied it with the chains to the tree in front of his hut. Everything is okay. But the story did not end up here. What had happened next? Next is next episode here. The kingdom where the potter is a subject was seized by the enemy. Seized, you know what it is? Captured. Lay around the country. Now, the king was in dangerous position. He was having a very great army, but he could not get a suitable person to lead the army to the victory. You see, you have everything with you. You have read well. You have practiced your mathematics well. You have done your science well. You have drawn the figures very nice. Everything is okay. But that has to be put in a right manner to achieve the goal. You have practiced. You have done well. You have read it. Everything is okay. But you should have the capacity to put it in a right manner. That's where the king was lacking. What is that one? He has a huge army, but he doesn't have a good person to lead it. As the commander, he was not having a good commander for his army. So he was a bit worried. Then the ministers, he called all the ministers and put this problem to them. How to solve this? I have a very good large army I am having. Good amount of ammunition I am having. Good amount of arms we are having. Good horses we are having. Everything we do have. But we don't have a person to lead it. Commander we do not have. General we do not have. Then one of the ministers stood up and advised him. Suggested him. Sir, I know. I heard about a man. But he is very simple. He is a potter. But how he works here, I do not know. But I suggest you that He should lead our army, sir, because he is brave. How do you know he is brave? Sir, he caught one of the tigers, very ferocious tigers, empty-handed, bare-handed, and he has ridden that horse the whole night, and in the morning he put it tied in front of his house to the tree with the chains. And if he is not brave, can he do all these things, sir? Certainly he is brave. Let us call him to lead our army. The king found it suitable to give this job to the potter. So the potter was called in along with his wife, and a very good, gracious, a very great house has been given to him, and also a great horse, a very high horse has been given to him, and he was entrusted the job. He was told, tomorrow you are leading my army to the victory. You have to defeat the king over there. By then, the enemy army, it has almost come near to the country's gates, and they stood all round. So the potter, the first place, he doesn't know how to ride a horse even. Let it go alone to have a sword to handle. He doesn't know even that. And where to say and where not to say, his misery, his sorrow, he could not express anywhere. But he wanted to try. Anyway, I am going to die. If I say I do not know this, the king would kill me. Better let me go and be killed with those enemies only, he thought. But he did not give up, you see. He wanted to practice what? Riding a horse first. So next day, early in the morning, he woke up before everybody, and he woke up his wife also. He said, let me try to ride the horse first. If I can control this horse, let me see what best I can do to save my country from the enemy. That way he explained her. The horse was very high. He could not reach. So his wife advised him, take this bench, put it there, and climb the horse. He did so. He was very comfortable. He felt it ease. Okay, good. But the legs from the stirrup, they are just slippery. And also when he was sitting on the saddle, he was feeling as if he is slipping down. So he asked his wife, bring some rope. She brought the rope. Tie my legs to the stirrups so that I should not slip down. So she tied him to the stirrup. Stirrup, you know what it is? Though it appears to be a donkey, but let me call it as a horse now. So the here, this is the saddle, and attached to it there will be a string, and here it is stirrup. And the rider always puts his leg here and goes around it. The other leg he will be putting. But here the horse is high. He could not reach, and so he put a bench over here, and he could able to go up. He never rode the horse. He was not knowing, but he felt the saddle bit slippery. He thought he will be slipping down. He may be falling down. He thought it. So he asked his wife to bring some rope and tie him to the saddle, right? And she tied his leg here to the stirrup, and he tied him to this saddle also. And over and above, she was left with a length of rope. What did she do is, she tied both his legs from this underneath, that stirrup and this stirrup, these two also she has tied. And that rope is touching to this animal's, this plank, body, that is the stomach. It was touching. It was irritating. The horse was making all along like this. Because you can see the horse cannot stand still. It will be always tip-tapping its feet, the hooves, tuck, 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 there itself in one place. It was doing that. Now, the potter asked her, to tie his hands to the neck. And the woman was doing that. Now once again, I repeat it. You see, the potter wanted him to be tied on the back of the horse to the saddle and his feet to the stirrup. The wife brings a length of rope and ties him to the stirrup, to the plank and to the saddle. Right? Make the rope go round his waist and tied it to the saddle. This around the stomach of this animal. The animal was a bit irritated. It was moving. And as it is, the horse never stands still. It will be always tapping its feet down. And moreover, the rider, the potter, wanted himself to be tied to the neck. Both the hands, he wanted to be tied to the neck. The wife was doing so. The horse got more and more irritated and it jumped out of the stable without giving any notice, nothing. It jumped. And the rider who was there tied to the back, he was completely frightened. He got panicky. And so he was pulling its hands, both the hands were tied to the neck, he was pulling. And as the horse neck was pulled, it is an indication to the horse to go fast. So the horse started running faster and faster. That is called galloped, galloped and galloped. As the potter could not control the horse, could not stop it, and moreover, he has seen the horse running through the empty streets and to the gate of the country, and it was running into the open fields. When it has gone into the open field, he has seen the horse is heading towards the enemy camp. He got completely frightened. And in the course of stopping the horse, he caught hold of one of the trees, nearby tree. It was young, and that means just then only it was planted. He caught hold of that, thinking that the horse would stop, right? But instead of the horse stopping, horse raced fast, but the tree had got uprooted. With a tree in one hand, apparently he is pulling the reins of the horse. He was not pulling the reins. He was trying to stop it. But apparently, as you look, when you look, it appears as if this man has uprooted a tree and put it here and he is trying to gallop. So this, a sentry of the army camp, he had seen. Who is coming? Yeah, this must be the great general. Who is that one? Tiger general. Why tiger general? He caught hold of the tiger empty-handed, bare-handed. Oh, this general, he is coming with a tree uprooted towards our camp. Come on, let us run away from the camp. That way he shouted. Everybody who was there sleeping or half sleeping, waking up, rising up, those have heard this. Come on, the great general, tiger general is coming with a tree in hand to kill all of us. This made the army people who was not armed, enemy army who was not armed, to run away. They have run. Those who are still there, they have seen their people are running away, so they also followed the suit. They also ran behind them. And soon, everyone from the camp ran away, excepting for the king. Only king was left. So the king has seen everybody has run away from his camp. He was alone there standing. What to do and what not to do? He could not think. Now, it is the best thing to make a truce with the king, to make peace with the king. Better. He thought about it. Hurriedly he picked up a paper and he put his words there and he kept the letter there. He too followed them, his army people. He too climbed a horse and went off. By the time the potter with the uprooted tree and the horse, when he had come over there, he had seen the complete enemy camp is deserted. Nobody was there. Then the horse, as if it tired, it stood there. He got a chance to put the tree down and remove all his bindings from the horse, and he climbed down the horse. Then, what am I to do now? The king had run away. But what am I to do here as a porter? Then he had gone into the king's camp. He had seen the letter and he brought it. And now he came back home all the way from the enemy camp to his home, walking with the horse beside walking. And he handed over the letter to his wife. You see, this is the letter. What is written over there, I do not know. But the enemy camp, everybody has left from there. Why? I do not know. And I am going to bed now. I am tired. Give this letter to the king. Right? So saying, he slept. Then the wife goes to the king and hands the letter over to the king. The king opens the letter, reads it. For his surprise, he comes to know that the enemy king, he went off from the camp and wanted to make a truce with him. Right? So that was the situation. How a king should react on this? He was very happy, overjoyed. He was triumphant because the victory is there. Even without a single drop of blood, the victory had come. That means his potter could able to bring him victory without any kind of disaster, destruction. So he praised the potter. Then he wanted him to meet. Then the wife said, no, we cannot do it because he is taking rest. Oh, let him take rest. Tomorrow I want to meet him. The next day, as appointed, the potter was called in. When he was called in, he was not knowing the riding of a horse. He doesn't express it to the people. He doesn't express it to the people. Simply, he walked along with the horse to the king's court. The people were thinking, you see, how the potter, how humble, how modest. Right? Very simple man he is, though he is a brave man, very courageous man. Because on the first hand, he could able to capture the tiger without any arm. He could able to capture the tiger. And here also, without taking any arm, only one tree, he just had driven away the enemy army. The king also had gone away. So there is no threat to our country. See the how great person he is. That way people are praising. He went to the king. The king offered him a very great gift so that he need not have to work anymore during his life. So far, so good. But if at all there is another war, what will he do? But for his luck, there were no more wars for him, and so he need not have to further bother about it. And so then he lived his life, remaining life, well. There ends the story. But what do we learn about it? What do we learn from this story? It is a very silly story. You may see to it. The potter capturing the tiger. Is it feasible? Is it possible? We may question ourselves. But it may occur. It may happen. You may capture a tiger. What is a tiger here in the story? Is it real tiger? No. Then whatever the thing threatens you, whatever the thing frightens you, then you have to conquer it. Conquer the fear. Conquer the threaten. Then you are victorious. There the tiger was there, right? If at all he knew that it was a tiger, he would not have caught it. But without knowing it is threatening me, he caught it. In the same manner, you should not mind whatever the fear encounters you. If at all you may encounter a fear or a threatening object, you need not have to bother, because you should be courageous. That way, again, this story is connected to the personality development. It tells how beautiful, how sweet, how gifting is courageous. Why I said beautiful is, if you are courageous, everything appears beautiful. You should be courageous. You should have confidence within you. In the next part, he caught hold of the tiger unknowingly when he was drunk, right? But second thing, he was knowing that he has to face the enemy people. They may kill him. If he says, I am not going to encounter them, I am not going to face them, the king may kill him. Either the way, this death is imminent, right? So he has to face it, either the way. So he got confidence. Let me try for a ride. Let me practice it first. Means, nahi suptasya sinhasya pravishanti mukhe mruga. The tiger or the lion is sleeping in its den, opening its mouth. No animal gets into it. If at all, though it is a lion, if at all it has a hunger to suffice, it has to go into the jungle and catch hold of its prey. Prayatnam, trial, you have to try for yourself. Without trying, you should not sit idle thinking that it is imminent, I'll have to face it. No, you face it, you see to it, then you may come up with victory. That says the thing here. Everything goes against the potter, we may see. The king's death, the king may become angry if he says, I do not know how I caught the tiger, I am not a general, I am not a brave man, I am a simple potter, I cannot fight. If he says that, the king may kill him. He may be angry with him. Right? If he goes and faces the enemy, they may kill him. Whatever the sequence, the result is same. But he did not bother for the result. Let me try it. That way, simply he started with a trial. But the trial itself turned to success. That is it. You have to try for the success. If not, the success will not come into your bag. It is not something very easy thing simply to put a pill like into your, pop a pill into your mouth. No, it is not a pill to pop in. You have to try hard to get the success.